Good morning, and welcome back to the New Leads Conference, Criminal Justice and the Media. My name is Alex Whiting. I'm one of the faculty co-directors, along with Professor Carol Steiker. Larry Schwartzstahl is the executive director, and we're excited to have this be our inaugural conference for the Criminal Justice Program of Research, of Study, Research, and Advocacy. I can never remember what the order is of those three things, but it's some order like that. Yesterday, we had our panel, and we talked about the new opportunity for media and the new moment. Some of the panelists described it as the golden moment for media and criminal justice, and an opening up of possibility, a new appetite for criminal justice stories and new forms of media to address those stories. And this panel, we're going to kind of go in the other direction and talk about the blind spots. What is the media missing? What voices are being missed? Who is the media speaking to? What perspectives are being missed? What stories are being missed, and why? What are the reasons for that? So I am going to briefly introduce our panelists because you have extensive bios for them. You'll notice that we're missing one panelist, bad weather in, I don't remember, Washington or New York. Washington prevented Vivian Nixon from coming up, but the three panelists that we have promised to fill us with brilliant insights and pithy, witty comments. I will have a conversation with them, but I will leave time plenty of time at the end for you to ask questions. So have your questions ready at the end. So let me introduce our panel. First, we have Julie Brown, who is a crime and investigations reporter for the Miami Herald. She previously worked at the Philadelphia Daily News and has been writing recently on prison conditions. Next to her is Lincoln Caplan, who is the Truman Capote Visiting Lecturer at Yale Law School. You'll see in his bio, he has written for number of publications and been associated with a number of publications, and he is presently writes primarily for the New Yorker and the American Scholar. Finally, we have Simone Weichselbaum. I had to work on that name, and that's the last time I'll say it. From now on, it's just Simone. Simone is a writer at the Marshall Project. Before that, she worked at the New York Daily News, and before that, she worked at the Philadelphia Daily News, where I learned last night she worked Julie Brown was her boss, and judging from the way the two interacted last night, apparently was a nice boss, a good boss. Like, they seem to still be friends, or maybe they're friends because she's no longer the boss. I don't know. That's the inside story that I don't know if we'll get. Simone, I'll put the first question to you, and I'm going to start with a pretty open-ended question. We talked yesterday, and you heard yesterday about, as I said, about this golden moment when all of a sudden there is a lot of media, not just about crime, but about criminal justice and about criminal justice process, and we have new media, new formats like the Marshall Project. That are devoted to criminal justice issues. And you cannot open the newspaper, any newspaper today, without reading a story about criminal justice. What stories are being missed?
Oh, there's still plenty. Well, to begin, I think what's really interesting is, yes, you do have a saturation at this moment of the mainstream media covering criminal justice, but still they're doing quick hits or flicking at the larger issues. So one of the first examples that comes to mind is that we're all aware of the mass release of federal offenders that occurred a few weeks ago. And when that first hit the media, there was sort of this fear-mongering moment of saying, oh my God, thousands of federal prisoners are being released from prisons from across the country. What's going to happen? They're going to be hitting the city streets. And because of the Marshall Project, we're all super nerds when it comes to criminal justice, you know, rather quickly learned that's actually not the case. What was being presented was a completely different narrative that when you actually interviewed folks from the Sentencing Commission or folks who actually study the issue. So it's still frustrating on one end that, yes, you do see sort of this plethora of headlines, but it's still like our purpose at the Marshall Project is to take the step back, to, you know, put more spotlight on an issue. It's needed more than ever, it seems, because just because you have this saturation doesn't mean the stories are being accurately told.
So, Julie, you work for a daily newspaper. Does your paper allow, the Marshall Project can write these long, in-depth stories and step back? Is your newspaper still trapped by the news cycle and by the quick
yes.
hit?
Yes, pretty much. I mean, in all fairness, I mean, they are devoting more time, more and more time to step back pieces, investigative pieces that take more time. But we're still a daily newspaper. The reality is you can't ignore the daily grind of news. You know, if someone gets murdered and it's a story about, you know, a child, for example, who is shot down in Liberty City, which is a very bad section of Miami, we still, on a daily basis, try to tell that child's story. And that's a grind every day trying to, you know. And the problem sometimes with daily newspapers and you know, we're shrinking because more and more people are reading their news online, is that there's less resources for us to do those kind of step back pieces and to sort of bring a couple of people. In the old days when newspapers were flush and everybody read us, we would be able to have the reporters on the daily grind of the story, but then we would take a couple other reporters and say, hey, let's look at Liberty City and let's do a big story about why are there so many murders and how many have there been, and you know, so we're really not doing that as much as we used to, so it's mainly because of the way newspapers are being stretched, you know, and they're just losing resources.
So, Lincoln, does that mean that this golden era is limited to Marshall Project and long articles that are in the New Yorker, or is it somehow nonetheless a change occurring in the quick media?
So Bill Keller said something really important yesterday, which is that criminal justice coverage is different from crime coverage, and most crime coverage happens in local media, whether it's local TV or newspapers that are left or the new online sites that are springing up in their place. And so there, one of the problems that's structural is that the thought leader publications, like the Miami Herald and the wonderful Marshall Project, are in a period of experimentation and growth, which is very exciting, but that is disconnected from the fear that still drives newsrooms that are shrinking. And the reason for hope is that the digital media make it possible for anyone to find her way to the Marshall Project. And they make it much easier for local media to decide they want to partner with the Marshall Project, or if one of the new long-form sites does something that is a story that implicates criminal justice, they can link to that or include it in their coverage. But there's still so many things that are being missed in the thought leader media. So an obvious one to me is the premise that criminal justice is separate from civil justice. You know, why has that arisen? Well, because criminal justice coverage comes out of cop coverage, and that's been a staple of journalism for a long time. There's an obvious drama to it, and it's attractive to a readership or a viewership or whatever. But it also traces back to the fight over legal services two generations ago, and the requirement by the conservative right that legal services not do class actions and not do criminal representation. You will see Very good pieces in The New Yorker, The Atlantic, The Marshall Project, The New York Times, The Miami Herald, a few other places that are about the collateral consequences on the civil side for a felony conviction. But it's spot coverage. And the anyone who's on this beat for a while recognizes that when you're convicted of a felony and do your time, your life is completely transformed with the form of civil death. There are so many jobs that by statute you can't get. You can't be a florist, you can't cut hair. And the consequences for your family are profound. And this is just starting to be studied by social scientists. Mm-hmm. But if the media just took away those blinders and recognized that there were a spectrum of related problems that start with a problem in the criminal justice system, but that dog someone for life and their family, it would transform the role of that coverage in the conversation about inequality in this country, as well as criminal justice. So, and there are just a bunch of blinders like that one, but that one's the most profound to me because it would lead to editors being much more enthusiastic when someone says, I want to talk about the consequence for a family of being ostracized in a community because of the perception of the extreme violence of this crime. All kinds of things that I think are implicated and would enrich and improve coverage if that false division were removed.
So, Simone, the Marshall Project is devoted to criminal justice issues. Does it suffer from this blinder problem that Lincoln is talking about? That are you sometimes concerned that your focus is too narrow, or are you able to? Are you an outlet that is able to connect to these broader social, economic, civil issues?
Well, our issue, criminal justice is very vast. And it's surprising on how many subtopics are touched upon it when you actually just start looking into criminal justice. But I think our issue isn't so much, what should we cover, it's manpower. We have a few, I believe 8 or 9 staff writers on board. We have a news meeting every day where we discuss what should we jump on, what should we not jump on, and we just don't have the staff, unfortunately, to chase every big idea. I have a whole backlog, we all do, of ideas we want to do, and when you're on one project, you're always thinking about the next one, and there's just so much to do. So it's not an issue of, does this fall into our wheelhouse, so to speak? It's how will I have the time to do it all? So that's what keeps us driven every day.
Why aren't there more Marshall Projects? Why aren't there local Marshall Projects or multiple Marshall Projects?
That's a really good question. I think an issue here, and I see Ken back there. Hi, Ken.
I think half your staff is attending
here,
this
right.
conference. So,
it's
yeah.
pretty true. I think the big issue, too, it's funding, number one.
Yeah.
So at the Marshall Project, our core audience are folks here in this room. It is the lawyers. It is those in the criminal justice field. It is not the mass media. So our issue isn't so much reaching the decision makers. It's reaching the normal folks on the ground. I'm aware Chicago had somewhat of a similar model going on, funded by the MacArthur Foundation, which, to my understanding, had lost funding. In the local world in New York City, when I worked for the New York Daily News, there were all these little blogs popping up in the neighborhoods. Some of it funded by people's own, dollars. Not really working. So it's how do you drive a conversation when most people who care about your conversation are sort of those in the choir, so to speak, like those who are signing the laws or those who spend a lot of time in law school and medical school researching this. And it's really hard to, push this. I was talking to DeRay about this yesterday. I always reach out to celebrities when I have an idea that sort of touches upon the celebrity world, and we never, ever, ever, ever hear back. And it's super frustrating because criminal justice affects all of us.
So I want to get back to, in a bit, to topics and subjects that you think could be covered more, that are hidden, that are missing. But something that I'm hearing in a number of your comments is that the audience is quite narrow in terms of this golden moment of media and criminal justice. Link, you talked about it as thought leaders. Simone, you've just talked about, you're speaking to the choir or speaking to lawyers. But there's a vast part of society that is perhaps missing this conversation. Julie,
but I think it's changing too. You know, we're a daily newspaper, so our audience is different. We're just, you know, Mrs. Smith down the street, so to speak, and or I don't know, on her computer. But I think it's changing a lot. I think it's because of social media that it's changing. There's never been, contrary to, you know, you think about newspapers all struggling right now and some of them closing. Actually, the world hasn't read news. They're reading news, people reading news now more than they ever have before. And it's mainly because of social media. Everything flies on social media. You know, one story I could write could get 2 million readers, you know, if it gets hit the right way. And so there's a lot of just regular folks, I think, that are waking up to the idea that our criminal justice system is broken. And I think it's a good thing. I think it's definitely, I hear from people all the time, you know, people who are, this issue touches almost every economic level. You're not just poor. You know, of course, I think that the poor and minorities often suffer some of the worst consequences of it. But we're talking about people in the middle class and even more affluent people who have had some aspect of their lives touch a police officer, you know, whether they're being pulled over or, you know, just even a silly, you make a illegal U-turn and to go through the court system to try to fix that and, you know, I didn't do it. And to you realize all the steps that it takes just to pay a ticket. So I think that the general public is becoming more acutely aware that the system is broken.
So I'm much less sanguine about there being a mass audience. And this is not the fault of the new media focusing on criminal justice. I mean, it really begins with the advent of the cable industry when there was a shift from broadcasting to narrowcasting and the recognition that you could make a lot of money by going narrower and deeper into a particular segment. And what we have now, optimism, encouraging statistics like the 45 or 50 million unique visitors to the New York Times every month. But when you look at who reads what and how much they read and how long they spend with a story, you realize that it's much harder to change policy through deep reporting now than it was 30 years ago, because you can't count on all of the members of Congress on both sides reading the same media outlets. You can't, in New York State, count on all of the decision makers doing the same thing. And so what has to happen is that thought leader publications have to, over time, build credibility with various segments that go out from an obvious core so that they have influence beyond the choir that expects to hear them preach. And that's really hard work. You know, if you're thinking to change the world and you've got a document that would change people's understanding, say, about prison rape, you know, you have a media strategy and you get some attention and nothing happens. And that's because this segmentation kind of dilutes the leverage of that. And if you look at the aspiration about the media's role in democracy from New York Times v. Sullivan, which reinvented the purpose of journalism in this country, we're just nowhere near that now. There isn't the ability of first-rate journalism to command the audience that you would expect from the power of its work. And so I think absolutely Julie's right that this is a story that affects everybody, and especially when they're touched by it, they seek it out. They do the same thing about crime that they do if someone has an illness in their family. They go online to try to learn about it, even if it's online at the public library. But for the media to play the checking function, the accountability holding function that we need it to, there needs to be much more inventiveness about how you move from this narrow casting to put together segments so you can have a broader effect, and I don't think anyone's figured out how to do that yet.
Okay, so what I see kind of emerging here from this conversation is two different kind of strands. There's the the mass media, mass public opinion, large scale public opinion effect, and then there is the question about how you speak to thought leaders and how that conversation goes. And Julie, you really, I think we're speaking about kind of the mass, and you're talking, Link, you were talking about the thought leaders. I want to come back to the thought leaders question, but just to pick up on what Julie was saying about the about talking, you know, this the mass public being interested in this issue. How what you described, Julie, is seems like an opportunity for newspapers and media, local media, to delve into this issue more deeply. And I guess my question is, what is, for that audience, what is more important? Is our big thought pieces, long investigative journalism pieces, more important? Or is it more important that the daily story get tweaked and get
the... Both, and that's what I've been doing for the past 18 months in investigating.
Like, give an example. What do you mean by that? What
have you been doing? Well, I started covering Florida prisons intensely when we got a tip about this inmate at a South Florida prison who had been put, and he was mentally ill, and he was put in, the guards put him in a shower, and they left him in there for almost 2 hours, and they turned the temperature up to 180 degrees. So he screamed and hollered, and they just sat there laughing at him. And, you know, we heard this tip, and we're thinking, where does that happen? That sounds like something that would happen in, you know, it shouldn't be happening in this country, that anybody should be tortured in that way. And so we started by writing this story about Darren Rainey, and it just exploded. And we just started writing sort of more and more, because more people started calling us. And so we, over the past year, went from writing that one story to, I've been back and forth balancing, trying to get out, you know, an investigative story almost like every week or every other week, to having now I'm working on a huge project. So I'm doing both, I'm juggling both, because you have to keep those the story alive out there, because that just, hard to say, but I think I get more information by just keep reporting it and keeping it alive. Lawmakers pay more attention, for example, because you're doing like a drumbeat and they can't ignore it. I mean, they have very short attention spans, I think lawmakers do. So they can't, they haven't been able to ignore the Miami Herald. That's what it's come down to. They can't ignore it, because it was just, every story led to another story of abuse, and it was one abuse story, and each one was worse than the other. And so it was the compilation of all these stories that has led to change in the Florida prison system.
Simone, you've worked for two very different kinds of publications. You worked for the New York Daily News, and now you're working for the Marshall Project. Can you compare those two outlets, and where is there greater potential for change, affecting change?
I just wanted to touch upon what Julie said. It reminds me of, I saw the movie Spotlight last week with some of my colleagues at the Marshall Project who haven't worked at a newspaper, and you're describing an era that no longer exists, mm-hmm. and you're very lucky to still be a part of it, and you know, I wish it still existed nationwide, and unfortunately it doesn't. And that sort of this tango dance we're doing at the Marshall Project, where the stories we all put, you know, many months into and many sleepless nights into aren't getting as much hits as, like, one of my colleagues did a fantastic job on doing a prison food slideshow. That was one of our most popular stories. Bill Keller had interviewed David Simon. That was a very popular story. My most popular story was about fake makeup in prison. So it's sort of, where do you draw the line? Where the New York Daily News, excuse me, you know, it was very common to have one of your stories mentioned on, like, Good Morning America or on national news. Alec Baldwin once said something bad about me, and that was national headlines on Twitter. But if you do a big story, even looking at, like, NYPD misconduct, that story will still only circulate amongst those affected by that, which is mainly those in minority communities. So just because, you know, we're at an outlet now, the Marshall Project, which is growing its brand, which is like making inroads, we're still sort of seeing the same impact with our stories that I did see at the New York Daily News, like sexy stories or puppies or food. That is more popular, unfortunately, with the masses than police abuse. It just is what it is.
Yeah. I want to come back to Lincoln's point about broadcast versus narrowcast, and whether when you at the Marshall Project, when you do deep stories, or Lincoln, when you do deep stories that for The New Yorker. Do you think about, I want to appeal to an audience that's beyond the converted? Or do you feel like you're speaking to the people who go read the Marshall Project are the people who are already persuaded by what you're going to say? Is there confirmation? In other words, is in the thought leader area, are people just confirming their beliefs in their media hits?
Well, it's most of us at the Marshall Project do come from traditional newspapers, so the New York Daily News, New York Times, Wall Street Journal, New York Magazine. And so we do know how to package a story so it can get hits. Just because we know how to do it does not mean we're going to do that. So a good example is I've been into writing about women who give birth in prisons and jails. And that's a story that I had sat on for months, is because how do you package that? It's so grotesque. It's, you know, you can list case after case, which at a tabloid you would do. You can go to town writing the horrific abuses that these women go through. And I sort of had to wait until I had a better angle. And the editor who worked with me on that, who also worked with me at the New York Daily News and came from the Wall Street Journal, we decided on focusing on reform. And until I came to her with enough evidence that, you know, this conversation's changing, we are seeing changes going on in DOCs and states, then she greenlit the story. So yes, her and I actually worked together at the New York Daily News, and we could have done a fantastic job writing a really gory story about women across the country who give birth and the babies die on the floor and the toilets. We could have done that, but would that have helped driven the conversation? And that's a debate we had internally.
Link, when you're writing your stories, who are you writing for?
I'm writing for the ideal editor, who I may or may not have. So one of the many smart things that Nick Lemon said when he was dean of the Columbia School of Journalism is that there's a tension between narrative and analysis. And it's often the case that you don't find the perfect story to carry the narrative that leads to the framing of the analysis and the reform that makes sense to you from lots of reporting. And one of the great things that's going on throughout journalism, from local papers with two or three reporters, especially at wonderful experiments like the Marshall Project, but also at traditional newspapers, with the hidebound conventions of the framing of stories as features or profiles or narratives, those are breaking down, and there's experimentation about. There are dramas of ideas now. You might have the development of an idea that circles around the chronicling of what happens to someone in prison, and that's important because cable news gave entertainment a really bad name, but journalism, at its best, is a populist form of art, and it needs to tell you something that you don't know. It needs to surprise you. It needs to hold you, so that you carry all the way to the end. And the infusion of ideas, the respect for the contribution that social science can make, which the Marshall Project deals with explicitly in its lab. That's so different from the journalism when Janet Reno's father, who was a police reporter for the Miami Herald, had his office at the police station, and he was basically just a PR guy for who they arrested. Journalism is changing in ways that reflect the background and aspirations of people in it, but also the recognition that on this issue now it can make a big difference. I write for different kinds of outlets, and I've got different responsibilities when I do that. But when I'm writing for The New Yorker online, I try to write as clearly as I can what really matters about the subject that I'm addressing. That's different from writing a talk of the town story. That's different from writing a 40,000 word piece run in two parts about the Office of the Solicitor General and how its politicization tells you what's happening to constitutional law in general. You know, the length, form, aspiration dictate what you're thinking about sentence to sentence and paragraph to paragraph. And I still hope write for that ideal editor because I know I need that feedback, however arrogant I may feel when I'm right in the heat of writing. I know that my work is generally improved by someone saying, do we really need that?
A number of things you have said. Simone, your initial comment about the narrative of surrounding the release of prisoners, a number of things that were said at yesterday's panel makes it feel like this moment, this golden moment, I keep calling it the golden moment, is a fragile moment, and that it could change, it could disappear with the election, or it could disappear if crime goes up, and there's some indication that perhaps it is, or if there is a spectacular crime or something. I guess I have two questions. One is, do you think it's a fragile moment that you're living in, that you're all kind of participating in different ways? And secondly, if that does happen, if there is a turn, will there be lasting changes from this golden moment? Are there things that have happened to investigative journalism, to the approach, to a more critical thinking that will be carried forward, that will survive any change that might be coming? Julian, why don't you?
I think personally, I mean, as a journalist, I mean, it's changed me. And if you change individuals even in an institution, I think that changes the institution to some degree. You know, the way
Can
that
you
I-
talk more about how it's changed you?
Well, I was a police reporter. I was one of those police reporters like Jan Arino's father, who was, you know, hanging out at the Roundhouse in Philadelphia and did the running gun, you know, every time a murder happened. And, you know, so I came from that background. And I always liked telling stories, you know, crime stories. And, you know, so I started actually when I joined the investigative team at the Herald, I started looking at racial profiling. I got a very good story, a tip about a convenience store in Miami Gardens, which is a little town, a suburb of Miami. A convenience store owner was basically got fed up with all his customers being roughed up by the cops. So he bought this like $50,000 camera system and he put it all over his store. And for months he just recorded the cops coming in and shaking down his customers. It was amazing. And so I did a story. It went all over the world, the story, because you could see, you know, you can't lie with a camera. You could see what they were doing to these poor people. So I think that story pretty much changed me. I realized that there was more to criminal justice and there was more to social justice and civil justice, to cover that I hadn't really done before. And I was able to do it because I also had editors that recognized it. You know, you can't do it without your bosses saying it's okay, you know. So I think because we had such a big response to that, we were able to just parlay that into one kind of racial profiling story after another. And then we started digging into the backgrounds of these officers who were doing this, and it turned out they had horrible backgrounds. You know, they had, you know, internal affairs investigations, and they were doing the same thing over and over, and nobody was catching the fact that these guys were, you know, doing this, mostly men. And so it started costing a lot of money, though, to do these kinds of investigations, a lot of money. And so, you know, you just kind of cross your fingers that the paper's going to be willing to spend it. You know, like I said, we have less resources. And one of the ways that these institutions, I mean, like police departments and places like that, one of the ways that they try to get it so you don't do their stories to make it very cost prohibitive. You know, one document, they'll say, well, we need $500 for that. Well, why is that one document cost $500? Well, because we have to hire somebody and they have to sit there and they have to redact all the social security numbers and all the addresses of the police officers and all the private information out of it. And that's going to take 5 hours and that person gets paid, you know, $20. I mean, it's absurd. You know, some of the things that they ask us to pay for. So I don't know if I answered your question.
Well, the point about the journalists themselves being changed is an interesting and important one. Link and Simone, what are your thoughts about whether this moment is fragile and if it changes, if the tide turns in the other direction, will some of what has occurred come to be survive that? What would it be specifically?
It'll be interesting to see. I know from where I sit on my perch, No, I think my next steps in life will depend on what happens in 2016 and then 2017, who's our next presidential administration moving into Washington. That's the big mystery, because the Obama administration has done so much, whether good or bad, whether you like it or not, focusing on criminal justice. It's been a big topic here in the States. We have the advent of terrorism yet again, sneaking its head back into this world.
Right.
So when that happens, then, you know, civil liberties goes back on the table. And one of my colleagues made a good point that once you start talking about terrorism and the police chiefs reacting to it, sooner or later it will become a local criminal justice story, as people talk about encryption again and they talk about surveillance again. So the topic isn't going anywhere. It's just more the funding for outlets like ourselves. Like, you know, the way the Marshall Project works, a lot of our money comes from foundations, you know, it's a couple years in, and then sooner or later they either renew us or they don't. And it will be interesting to see if that does not happen, God forbid, what will be our next steps. I don't have the answer to that. And it's very troubling that newspapers, you know, I was lucky to see the last few golden years of newspapers, and I work for you in Philadelphia, Knight Ridder, which is a company that no longer exists, for example. That's how I started my career. It's not like that anymore. Young journalists, and I'm 34, people who are 24 starting this business don't have the same path I have, and they never will, and it's a shame. And I don't have an answer, and I don't think many of us in journalism have an answer of what the field will even look like in 2 years. It's just moving so rapidly.
Just to add to what she said, I think what she does now with the Marshall Project is a lot different than what I do. But everybody reads everybody else. So when we read the Marshall Project, for example, and we look at how they might have expanded a story, it sort of makes us think, well, maybe we should do it. So I think because even though we're come from two different places, there is a cyclical effect that we sort of, it makes us think, and it makes us do things a little bit differently. So I think it's a good balance, I guess is what I'm saying.
So there one element here is the business model and the uncertainty of the business models, plural, for the for-profit ventures, for the not-for-profit ventures that have a educational and a social purpose. And each of them needs time, but there is the question of value in the marketplace, and there's value to society. And the more great work that the Miami Herald does and new ventures like the Marshall Project, the more they're underscoring their value, and the harder it is for funders to walk away from that, even though foundations like to invest in the new and like at some point after 5 years or 10 years or whatever to see something like a self-sustaining model. That isn't the case for any nonprofit, except one that exists as an extension of government. And so that's a big uncertainty. Another huge change in the ecosystem, though, is the organizations that are feeders of analysis and information and perspective, and just in the criminal justice area, Mothers Against Drunk Driving, the Sentencing Project, the Death Penalty Information Center. I mean, there are lots of them, very talented people working at them, functioning in a way parallel to journalists in gathering essential information and presenting it in a way that is immediately useful to us if we're writing about that subject. And so whatever happens in journalism, and I'll make one other point that will mark me as an optimist, these organizations have changed the field, and they've raised the expectation about the practical utility of information and perspective opinion in it. I'm optimistic because the most changed institutions are journalism schools. They used to be training grounds for people who, if they were lucky, went through from a local newspaper to a regional one to a national one. And now they're doing journalism. They're not just training people. And so their faculties are increasingly filled with people who do really good journalism as well as teach really well. And they are, in a way, are going to hold journalism itself accountable. And just repeating a point I made earlier about the funding issue for nonprofits, well, there's much less of it than I'd like as a consumer. And it's, if you did it, quantified it, it's a minority of coverage. There is so much more really useful, interesting, compelling coverage about criminal justice now than any time in the history of American journalism. And that's going to be very hard for the profession, if we can call it that, to walk away from whatever funding models end up resulting. Yes, it's a really tricky, uncertain time for someone who wants to be a journalist, but my sense is it's the best time to enter journalism in my lifetime. That the lack of hierarchy means that if you have gumption and talent and prove yourself in your blog or with a particular story, you get embraced. You may get vastly underpaid, but you will have opportunities to make a difference in journalism. And in that sense, while journalists don't like to think of themselves as engaging in public service, they are, in the sense that they can change how we understand something important about how the world works. And the number of young people who are doing that now as opposed to 40 years ago is really remarkable.
So just to build on that point, it sounds like that there's opportunity in the kind of democratization of the media process, and also, which also comes with, and with it comes specialization. Is that kind of, do you see that? And Julie and Simone, do you see that? Do you, when you talk to, Simone, you talked about how the golden era of newspapers you sort of caught the tail end of it. What do you think about Link's vision here? When you talk to journalism students or young people who are interested in going to journalism, are you optimistic or?
I'm going to disagree with you, if you don't mind. I think when you saw the end of traditional media and the training programs, the internship programs that were extremely competitive and all those things I went through, you take away sort of the ability of people, like myself, people of color. I grew up in Brooklyn. My parents don't have a lot of money. Of not only entering journalism, but being able to support yourself and have a future and not say I have to quit or be saddled with a shitload, excuse me, I curse, sorry, of student loans. And what you see now are sort of, unfortunately, privileged people. I'm not going to pick a color here because you can be privileged from any background, whose parents can afford to pay for their apartment in New York, or who, you know, don't mind living with three people in a two-bedroom apartment in an unsafe place in Brooklyn, which some of my colleagues have to do. And can that sustain itself? When you're 24 or 25, perhaps, but when you're 34, 35, and you want to have a family, and you're thinking of settling down, you can't. And because you sort of had this disintegration of newspapers and even traditional network news and those opportunities they gave to young journalists, especially those from lower or middle class backgrounds or those from minority households, you sort of did away with the democratization of newsrooms. Like, diversity is not doing so well anymore. And even when I worked at the New York Daily News, I'm biracial, so I'm black and Jewish, and was really able to cover those two communities. And then we had two African American reporters. And now we're down to someone who's half, my former paper, half black and half Dominican, covering New York City. Our whole big newsroom has one person of color, not even an Asian or a Pakistani or someone else. That is pathetic and that is sad. And then the Marshall Project, I know we work really hard on trying to recruit more people, and there's just not a lot of talent because the young folks, the few that actually want to do this and are saying, yes, I'll make not a lot of money, very small handful, and those people like myself who come from traditional newspapers, that is really hard to lure away a reporter from the New York Times or the Washington Post, someone of color, someone who is known, who has a great reputation, to come work at a startup that may or may not survive in 5 years. So that's like what we're up against. So yes, I think it is a golden age for those whose parents can subsidize them, but for people like myself, it's scary.
Julie, are you seeing the same thing? And
I don't know. It sort of seems like a deja vu for me because, you know, I'm older, and when I started, it was like it is now. It was. It was like nobody wanted to be a journalist. You didn't get paid anything. If you went to be a journalist when I started out, you better just realize you're not going to make any money, and you do it for the love of it, and you know, I felt like it was the only thing I could do. I felt like I couldn't do anything. I actually went into public relations because I thought, I'm never going to make money as a journalist, so I better have a fallback plan where I could work in business and do public relations. But once I got a job in at a newspaper, I wasn't going back. And I sort of went into it thinking, I'm just going to be poor the rest of my life. So it's kind of an amazing ride for me that I ended up where I am, because I never thought it would happen. So, and I've gone through, the newspaper business has gone through a roller coaster ride during my lifetime. And, you know, I've been through really bad times before where they were laying off like they are now. And you know, you thought you're gonna lose your job any day. And so I guess I'm a little more optimistic too, because I think that the digital world is changing journalism. It's changing everything, you know. And I think that I'm hopeful that the newspaper business or the journalism business is going to find a balance and a way to work out things so that people will be able to sustain careers in journalism in one way or another. So Like I said, I've seen it bad before, so I guess I'm just hopeful that something will happen and some greater minds will prevail on how to make it work.
I'd like to start your list of things that you can do for journalism. One of them is...
That everybody can do.
No, that you and this program can do.
Larry, take notes.
You can finding the money to support Marshall Project, pilot projects at the... At the local level, that might be bureaus of the Marshall Project, but also have a standalone function. That would be a highly leveraged investment and a relatively inexpensive experiment that could really pay off big time. The second is that you ought to put together a bunch of money to invest in a diversity program. And the reason is not for the young men and women who are very talented, happen to be a minority and need to worry about their college loans and need to make a living. It's because it's better for journalism. Every institution is always improved by diversity. You can define it in lots of different ways, but when you have diverse perspectives, it's just better for collective understanding and decision making. And that's a blind spot of mine. And if that's a need, that's a highly leveraged investment. Some foundation could make a transformative contribution to journalism, because there are students in journalism school who have made the bet. They've got a scholarship, and they've made the bet that this is what they want to do, and they'll find a path. And then you can help them find that path to wherever they end up going. This is a pipeline problem as well.
But
journalism ought to be competing for the talent in that pipeline. And so that's the second big thing I think you could make a huge difference in.
Those are terrific suggestions. So I want to shift a little bit the conversation and pick up on a point that Julie made about video. We all know the ways in which video has transformed the criminal justice topic, and I think transformed also journalism and media. Video now embedded now at citizen video. Everybody has, there's a transparency. Do video, and we'll have some panels later that will focus more on this. Are there ways in which the video technology creates its own blind spots? Right? Are there things that, and Julie, you're nodding your head. Are there things that are not on video that are now more hidden than ever?
Yeah, a lot of it, you know, video can be taken out of context, just like when you write something in a vacuum. If you film something in a vacuum, if it's taken out of context, it can do more damage than anything else. I mean, I really believe, you know, video is a good thing, because we see things that we would have never seen before. You know, my example before about the convenience store owner who had all that video in his store, and he took the police officers. But let's just say, for example, the guy that he was shaking down before the part before that was the guy pulling out a gun at him or something, you know, and that part wasn't on the video. You know, so I think that's why, you know, you can't just be a videographer. You have to be a journalist, and you have to ask the question, like, where's the piece of video that happened before this? You know, what was happening? Or also, even outside the video, interview the people that were there and say, the video shows this. Is this exactly what you saw? I mean, you have to take it, you know, another step and not just rely solely on video to tell the story.
When you try, Simone and Link, when you try to write longer pieces, tell deeper stories, get behind the story, causation, trends, are those harder, easier, given the kind of quick hit, video, sensationalist journalism that is that is predominant even in this criminal justice field. Even as we've moved away from it bleeds, it leads, it's a different kind of drama, perhaps, and individual stories that might be dominating the news. Is it harder, easier to tell the deeper story?
I think one of the first things I had to learn working at the Marshall Project, coming from the quick hits of the New York Daily News, was putting on the blinders and just putting your head down and just focusing on your project. And so it was something Bill had to sort of verbally beat into me over and over again, because we work on big projects, especially on policing. You know, you're working on whatever city, like I'm working on a city now, and you know, there's news coming out of that city, and you get super excited, and oh my God, does that change this or does that change that? And he's like, stop. So you have to learn to like ignore it almost when you're doing this type of work, because if you start off with like, this is what I'm going to investigate, here's this bigger problem, which we are investing our time into learning and uncovering, it really doesn't matter what viral video, even if it's unfortunate, even if it shows an officer like killing someone, you just have to like, you know, you could consume the news, but you can't stop what you're doing just because it's a big deal at that moment. Because especially on the national policing beat, there's just video after video and protest after protest now, and you have to really stop and take the step back and really try your best to dig into the deeper issues.
So one of the big blind spots generally about criminal justice coverage has to do with the fact that our country right now basically has a plea bargain system, that most cases are resolved that way. It's not a secret. Even Justice Kennedy has written about it for the Supreme Court. But it hasn't changed the frame of coverage of local cases, and it hasn't changed the approach of many people who are really good covering criminal justice. So, could someone do that story visually as well as someone could make that point and explain its consequences in print? Absolutely. But you would need that someone to be hip to that idea and as skillful with her visual storytelling as the woman who might do the explanatory piece in 1,500 words or 6,000 for a magazine. So you need the background and the openness of mind and the intellectual agility as well as the visual storytelling ability for someone to do that. And there aren't lots of outlets for that 3-minute piece or 5-minute piece or whatever it ends up being, but there are many more outlets today than there were 10 years ago, 20 years ago. So I'm agnostic about the medium. I agree with Simone that it can be annoying to feel like you're going to be scooped when you've actually started to figure out something out that it doesn't appear that someone else has yet, and you feel that by the time you come out there'll be no interest because people think that they have seen that story. But the right thing to do is just to keep your head down and do the great job in reporting and writing it, because it's likely to change minds for the people who see it. And I'd love to see more law schools investing in video visual storytelling the way this one is. It's a great leadership commitment, and it will be wonderful when the business model of the Marshall Project succeeds so that everybody can get trained
and it will.
I love this guy.
Visual storytelling.
So I'm going to open it up in a minute. I just have one last area I wanted to cover. You talked about, Simone, you opened this up, and you all talked about the question of diversity among journalists. What about diversity among sources? When I've been on the receiving end of journalists in work I've done in practice, oftentimes what we'll say is that journalists are lazy, that they'll always go to they'll Google who's the person who has spoken before on this subject, call them up, and it's always the same character speaking on the subjects, and that there are lots of voices that never get heard. Is that a blind spot?
Mm-hmm. It's definitely a blind spot. I'm guilty of it. I mean, because it's, sometimes it's all I can do, you know, because the story's due tomorrow. And you can't, you know, I try sometimes to call other people with other organizations, but, you know, when you have somebody's cell phone on your phone, it's just easier, you know, when you're on deadline. That's not to say, you know, when you do a long piece, that's part of your research in addition to worrying about the storytelling and getting the documents you need. You have to almost do the research on getting the experts that you need and who they are. You know, it isn't just Googling, it's talking to one source who leads you to another source. You call universities, you call hospitals, you call think tanks. I mean, it's almost, you could spend a whole week just getting a list of experts that you want to use in a story. It's time consuming, and most journalists really don't have the time or take the time, or their editors don't give them the time to really do that. A lot of editors don't realize how hard that is, quite frankly. They just expect you to just get a comment, and they don't realize how hard it is to get a diverse comment.
I think that's one of the beauties of a place like the Marshall Project, where you have the time and the expertise. So we all never, ever try to just, you know, repeat what everyone else is saying in the media. I know what I do is I, you know, are constantly going through lawsuits when I work on a story and figure out, like, who I should call just based on reading that. I do work closely with the sources I've built up over the years, and even if they don't want to go on record, they usually can put me in touch with someone who maybe just left an agency who doesn't mind going on record, or who can pass me a document that I can just start off with. I generally, in all my stories, really do try my hardest to reach out to people who generally do not talk to media, because the people who talk to media over and over again, you know, why are they doing that? Then I start getting suspicious of them, they don't trust what they're saying, and they don't use the interview anyway, and it's just like a waste of everyone's time.
So there are two different kinds of bias that I see repeated again and again. One is the obvious one of left-right ideological. I think the more troubling one is that most journalists end up having incomplete sources in the criminal justice process. So they never speak to judges, or they rarely speak to judges, because judges are mistrustful of journalists, and they're also concerned about the ethical propriety. Prosecutors have a command and control approach to dealing with journalists. When they want to get a message out, they talk with them. When they want to leak something, they talk with them. But they are royalty in the criminal justice system and tend to act that way. So if it takes a while to build up sources all the way through the process, so that you're representing each of the obvious points of view, and the other thing is that you can be a respected and effective journalist in your pajamas at your desk. You don't have to ever get dressed and go outside your house, and the world doesn't need to know that. And reporting, going to talk with people whose lives are affected by the crime or a change in policy, they might not know it. You might have to explain, this just happened, what do you think about it? That's, you know, a kind of person on the street reporting, or people in a community that doesn't get well covered because there's a newsrooms are tight with staff. I mean, that kind of reporting is also not done enough, and that's a real blind spot. Journalism isn't easy. It takes commitment, and it takes leaning forward in lots of different ways, intellectually and in terms of how you understand who has a stake in the process, but also where you go. And some of that's money, but more of that is mindset.
Okay. I'd like to open it up for questions. If you have a question, you press on the button, and you have to hold the button. Carol.
So this has been great. One of the blind spots, or one of the things I find frustrating in this moment, I'm a huge consumer of the Marshall Project and of, you know, long form and short form reporting on criminal justice, is what I might call sort of the dog that didn't bark reporting, or what Bill Keller yesterday in the panel called solutions reporting. And Simone, your example of trying to talk about reformers in the context of women giving birth in prison as opposed to the baby in the toilet kind of reporting. But I feel like the baby in the toilet reporting is so dominant, important. I mean, expose, terrible things are happening. There's an enormous amount of unnecessary human suffering involved in the criminal justice system, which is one of the reasons I think we're in this moment. But I think too much of our attention can be drawn there in a kind of car wreck kind of way, as opposed to the good cop, the good prison or warden or practice. You know, what's working, what might work? And I feel like I'm hungry for more of that. And I wonder if you agree that there's about this thing that I feel like I've observed, and what might get us more of solutions reporting. I'd welcome your thoughts.
I agree, but it's sort of the issue again that we touched upon. It's sort of like the mass audience, like a story that has sad visuals of like the whole thing about women who give birth in prison. Like we didn't publish photos of a woman who had the 3D sonogram. Her lawyer had sent us of the baby. Her baby was stillborn. So we had a 3D sonogram of the baby right before it was born, i.e. right before it died, and there was a debate in the newsroom whether or not do we run just like the normal sonogram people are used to looking at, or do we do the 3D image? I voted for the 3D image, and Bill did too, but then other people felt like, no, it's too gruesome, we're not doing it. And so the question is, do you want to tell the story that you know people will click on, that you know people will read and be like, oh my God, or do you want to tell the story that actually says, hey, here's this jail we found and they're changing? So the sexier story is a former example, of course. And coming from my tabloid background, I always vote to do the sexier story, but this is why I work with really smart editors who are like, no, we're not doing that. We're actually gonna do the story that maybe won't get as many hits, but actually tell something that no one knows about. Here's this little jail in Arkansas that's trying to reform. So it's sort of the same subject matter, what road do you wanna go on? And I think it matters where you work and who your editors are and who is your audience, and back to the debate on whether or not, do you want your stories to have clicks or do you want your story to have impact? I don't know.
I think newspapers, I think we try to do the reform angle when we cover a story. We try to, you know, that's one way we can point out to people, this is why it's so wrong, is by saying it can be done this way, you know. And so I think, you know, especially with the criminal justice resurgence of journalism in criminal justice, I think more and more we are really looking for solutions. You know, it's harder to find sometimes because, quite frankly, this is still an open wound. It's still a big problem, you know, sentencing and plea bargaining and just that angle, as we mentioned earlier, judges don't want to talk. I mean, some of the best accolades I've had on my work are from prosecutors, public defenders, and I'm thinking, you've known about this all along? Why didn't you talk about it before? You know, they've known about all this horrible thing happening, but none of them have spoken up. Nobody that I knew, and I was a crime reporter for ages, and I covered courts and, you know, all kinds of things, and nobody came to me and said, do you realize this is what's happening? You know, do you realize that people in Florida prisons are being tortured? Do you know that? Nobody, it's just like this dirty little secret that's been going on in criminal justice community for a long time. I don't understand why nobody's really stood up and said, wait a minute, you know, you guys are missing this story here.
Has anyone here seen the movie Absence of Malice?
Yeah.
So this is a movie, 30 years ago,
yeah.
Set at the Miami Herald, and it's about how horrible it is to be covered by an earnest journalist. And so one of the problems is that there's so much mistrust. It's the Janet Malcolm issue. It's whose story is it? You see the problem. If you're a prosecutor, you actually have a thought about reform and you're talking with colleagues about it. But you know that when you hand it over, it's going to become a different story. And that remains, as it's been for a long time, a big issue. About 25 years ago, there was a focus on civic journalism, public journalism. Jay Rosen at NYU, Jim Fallows in his book Breaking the News. Fallows was briefly the editor of US News, and I was lucky enough to work with him there. And a number of people who were there have gone on to affirmatively try to do solutions journalism. Paul Glastris, who's the editor-in-chief of the Washington Monthly, Steve Waldman, who started a wonderful publication called BeliefNet, then got sold, that was about solutions, about religion of all kinds. To me, the way that journalism's really going to make progress on that is when it gives up carefully and reluctantly the church-state separation between editorials and the news whole. The way it now works is the people who can write about solutions get 350 to 500 words on the editorial page. So they can't really explain what the problem is, let alone how the solution is supposed to work. And occasionally, if they're very lucky, they get a column. And if you're very shrewd and good, the way Brent Staples, who was here yesterday, does, you actually build a case over time. So readers recognize that they're getting a chapter today, even though it's self-contained. But one of the great things about the kind of broken business model and the experimentation in journalism is that it's possible for someone who is a really careful reporter and an excellent writer who also understands the relationship between the problem and the solutions that she's hearing from sources can file a piece that will get to the possible solutions and without feeling like that's impinging on opinion territory. But journalism is hidebound, and that separation is taken very seriously for good reason. You don't want people to be so biased in their reporting that they only hear what's going to lead to the solution that they think is right. I mean, back to Nick Lemon, one of his tests for a good reporter is whether she's gone out and tried to disprove her hypothesis about a story. So, you know, the effort is there, and journalism hasn't figured out how to do it as well as possible. But if it's ever going to do it, it's going to be now in this era of experimentation.
Yes, ma'am. Yeah, it's the weirdest thing, but you just hold it and speak sort of close to it, and it should work. So I think, Julie, you've written a lot on this.
Yeah, it's a very good question. It really is. I've worked really hard to get inside Florida prisons, and it isn't easy. I'm to the point now, from where I started with, you know, trying to get into the prisons, that something will happen somewhere in a Florida prison, and I will call the Department of Corrections, and I will say, why was Medevac chopper at Suwanee Prison today, and they will not know that it is even going on in Tallahassee. So they are learning from me because I have so many sources now that are contacting me. What I will say, and I also said this when I was just reporting on bad cops, so to speak. There are a lot of good police officers in America, and there are a lot of good corrections officers in prison systems all over the country. And they have their heart in the right place. And believe it or not, some of my best sources are the good corrections officers who want to get rid of and the same thing with police. The bad cops the good cops don't want these bad cops. It gives them a bad reputation. So some of my best sources, they can't always give their name on the record, but they'll tell me, and I usually go and I verify what they're saying. You don't take everything that they say as gospel and go write it, but you can verify it. I think that that's also part of what's going on with reform in this country, in that I think corrections officers and people who work inside the prison system are really finally feeling like people are understanding. I've been saying this for years, and now there's this reporter here in Miami who's writing this, and they're constantly, I get so much mail, so many, I get emails every single day. I got one last night saying, I'm a corrections officer in a facility and something just horrible happened and I want to be a whistleblower and call me right now, And so it's changing. It still works. Because the official sources in the prison system want to discredit me at every turn. For a while there, when I would write a story about something that happened, they would immediately put out a press release saying, to the whole state, saying, you heard it wrong in the Miami Herald. And they would go down and they would pick apart everything in my story. And it just was exhausting, because then we had to go look at the story and say, oh, did we get this wrong? Did we get that wrong? And that's part of the strategy that they have, discredit the messenger. So.
Can I ask a follow-up on that? Has the changes in journalism and some of the resistance that you describe from official institutions changed any journalistic practices, anonymous sources or anything like that? Or is there no evolution or change or in that?
I think just journalism in general doesn't really have anything to do with criminal justice particularly. I think just journalism in general, we use less anonymous sources just because of the way that it's changed. We've come to just rely on I'd much rather have someone on the record, but you can't. If somebody works for a prison, they're going to get their job, they're going to get fired if they talk to you. So you have to vet them more. You have to ask for their personnel file, make sure that they don't, have a vendetta against anybody. So
So that's the rule. If you have to rely on an anonymous source, then you're required to push more or get corroboration.
I do. I don't know if everybody does, but I do, and I also try to get other sources that are telling me the same thing. I try to find somebody who will tell me the same thing on the record. Your anonymous source might just point you in a direction where you'll eventually find someone who will tell you, or you'll find a document that will tell you. Something in the court record, a lawsuit that was filed. You get very creative in trying to find a way to confirm the anonymous source. There's all kinds of ways.
Do you have anything? Okay.
So, let me just say one thing about that. There are two steps to this process. One of them is you want to be confident that you understand the story that you're reporting on. And at that point, it may be tactical that you don't want to hear something, quote, off the record, or even on deep background, because you are concerned that you couldn't then persuade someone to let you put that on the record. But with a more complicated story, I want to talk with as many people as I can with different perspectives, and I don't really care whether it's on the record or not. I want to try to figure out the story. And sometimes I'll go back to those people and say, you said this especially well. I'd like to use this, and sometimes they say, that's fine, and sometimes they say, oh my God, I didn't realize we were on the record. But that's about credibility. The first is about getting the story right. The second is about how you present it and how you make it as credible as possible. And of course, any editor wants no blind quotes, wants to make sure that there are representative people on the record, and so that it looks like a fair story as well as being a reliable story. But they're two different parts for me.
Okay.
I'd just like to add one little thing to that regarding inmates. You know, a lot of my stories, I interview inmates, and the biggest thing that, you know, you worry about is, you know, of course the Department of Corrections is going to say, hey, you're interviewing a convicted felon. How credible is this person's story? So, you know, for example, I'm working on the women's prison right now, and most of it is anecdotal from women describing their experiences. So, you know, of course the department, when I bring up something that's happening in the prison, they'll say, well, you know, these are all inmates, they're all lying. But when you have 50 inmates telling you the same story, you just have to work harder when, you know, the source inmates, for example, might not be as credible. You have to work harder to show the patterns, to show that, you know, that this is something that's been happening.
Yes, sir.
Hi, I'm Perry Gedurgis. I'm an emerging documentary filmmaker, media series, and I have a project called 100 Less Court Dates and a Wake Up, stories about successful reentry. And like the other question, I was formerly incarcerated in the 70s, editor of a jail newspaper called the Centennial Slammer. And I'm a little curious that they're like that, that you have prison legal news, you have former editors who are now out. Angola had famous newspaper. San Quentin Prison Film School that the Discovery Channel did. Inmate-run radio shows, authors of memoirs, which there's dozens and dozens and dozens of them, and who some are white-collar criminals and maybe have a different way of articulating their stories towards policy and such. So one of the things that I navigate this, and I've been out on the street since the 70s, and was two things. It's like, why care? Like for readers, like our society, why should we care? We have compassion fatigue. And we're pulled in so many directions. I notice that when I read my headlines, my own local newspaper in Maryland, is I have to force myself sometimes to read a veteran's story or to read somebody's tragedy story. And I've been turned on by this new sort of genre. Maybe it's not so new. It's called restorative narrative. And the images and voices of hope is driving that. I've just gotten turned on to them more recently. And so as I'm trying to tell a collection of stories to let that then be a story, I'm wondering if anybody, either through the day that wants to come up to me afterwards or this current panel, can speak to sort of a rambling question here. It is, how can more people like myself and those kind of efforts get out there, given the challenges and pitfalls and biases that you guys have spoken to? Can I add one caveat, too? Addiction and alcoholism, that's my real driving force, and not just the war on drugs that was spoken to last night, but if you separate that, you still have that it still causes violence. The usage, not the sale, that gets you incarcerated or small possession, but the actual driving addiction. I mean, that's why I'm out, because I'm sober 37 years in recovery. But how that's not so covered as well. And anyway, thanks.
So at the Marshall Project, we do have a space called Life Inside, where we invite inmates from prisons, federal and local, from across the country to write for us. So it's definitely, and we do have a relationship with Prison Legal News, so I definitely will give you my card after and put you in touch with the right folks. So thank you for sharing that.
Are there other questions? Oh, sorry, I didn't see you.
So it's been terrific to hear from journalists talk about what traditional media has been able to do in this space. It's been interesting that a lot of the attention towards criminal justice, particularly within the system of arrest and use of force with arrest has had a lot to do with citizen media, has a lot to do with sort of citizen surveillance through things like mobile phones. I'm just curious if I could get you to sort of address the ways in which the changing nature of media production, the fact that everybody with a phone now has that possibility of producing media, the ways in which now challenges of sort of verification and contextualization are changing how the mainstream press reports on this. It's interesting in particular that we've been talking about stories of people who are already incarcerated where that hasn't had an impact for obvious reasons, but I'd be curious to hear you sort of reflect on these questions of how that ability to author media may be changing the broader press picture around criminal justice.
Well, so at its best, citizens journalism is a accountability journalism, and the dramatic race related stories of the last 18 months have been credible and have been treated as social events because of citizens journalism. So at its best, it's really important. I think if you heard journalists speaking frankly about this, their hesitation is the leap to the premise that therefore there's no difference between someone who's a trained journalist and someone who's a citizen journalist. And it may well be, I mean, there are lots of self-trained journalists who have had profound impact in mainstream media. I mean, when I first went to The New Yorker, it seemed to me it was a requirement to have dropped out of a Texas college or university to be an influential editor there. So it's happened for a long time, especially before fancy pants became journalists, and you know, starting in the 30s and 40s, where people were citizen journalists in a way. And then the question is, what do mainstream journalists have to learn from citizen journalists about reporting, about being there, about bearing witness and having evidence of that, and vice versa. It's a conversation that's going to go on for a long time.
Okay, I think we will bring this to a close, and I will ask you all to join me in thanking the panel for really a terrific discussion.